Hotep community, welcome back to First Frequency of Oneness, Shock Metaphysics. Yep, it's your guy, the Metaphysical Morpheus, aka Rev Shock, Shockimus Prime, Shook Shock, Shockalicious, and all the wonderful things that come with breath mints. We're back with Dr. AJ Varmah. That's what it means. It's time. It's that once a month fix that we have to have from this dynamic brother, from another mother, and from the mother country. Dr. AJ Varmah, welcome back. How have you been, my brother?
Oh, Rev Shock, I'm doing well, staying busy, and we're active. As long as we're active, that means we're alive.
Absolutely. So the last few times that you've been here, we've been talking about this concept of Africa's culture that breeding European beliefs, and you know, this has been a very powerful discourse and dialogue, and of which you ain't ready, you ain't finished yet with us. You have some more to share with us on this concept and understanding, because I was just having this conversation with my deacon this morning. We're in a very precarious place right now. As these people are dying off, their ideology is still remaining in many of us. And so they're leaving, Amma is taking them out, but they're leaving a self-destruct switch upon their demise, which is why this conversation, I believe, is so radically important. Your thoughts on that, beloved, or that frame?
We know that the melanin recessive genealogy is dying off. We know that. But what we must be mindful of is, as it's dying off, have they been able to transfer their energy, which is what you're saying, into our bodies, wherein become white people in black skin?
Mm-hmm.
Be mindful. Because remember, they knew that the prophecies or the predictions of the ancient scribes and teachers and priestesses was that they would only exist for about 6,000 or so years. Mm-hmm. And that they would reach the expansion point. That's why they're fighting so hard, for example, the whole anti-abortion. And I'm not pro war, it's not my business.
Right, right.
Because they know that as a white woman aborts her fetus, or in Japan, as a Japanese woman, or in China, you know, these are places that are having difficulties breeding a next generation, or bringing forth the next generation. So as the great Francis Cress Rawlson taught us in the ISIS papers, it's about white genetic survival. As the great Robert Lee Fuller taught us, if you don't understand racism, white supremacy, how it works, how it's constructed, everything you seek to understand will confuse you. Their moves are always made from the perspective of survival. And if they're dealing with genetic survival, then they understand that their genes are dying off. But if they can transplant that gene into melanated bodies, either consciously through music, television, or some other medium, or through genetic intermixing or interbreeding willingly, as we're doing now, then they will be able to survive as European in black skin. But here's the issue we're faced with. When you and I look at this idea of genetic survival, it has to first, where we come to in, we have to first say to ourselves, everything we say to our students all the time, presume all that you've been taught, that everything you've been taught, Baba Henry Clark, has been a lie. Now, that's one presumption. We accept that everything we've been taught has been a lie. Put that here. So everything we're going to think naturally, as they've produced us, you know, or influenced our minds, lie. Now, everything our ancient African and Caribbean and indigenous masters and mistresses, the female, you know, masters, taught us is true. Now work life towards defending and proving that truth. Mm-hmm. We've spent life always skeptical about our African theology, cosmology, sciences, metaphysics, music, architecture, culinary, medicinal practices, surgery. We've always looked at ours as other and theirs as the right. Now we must start looking at theirs as other, which is what it actually is, because it's not ours, and looking at ours as right and seeking the answers to the questions, but not from a perspective of what if this isn't true, but from the perspective of this is true, thus let me prove it. Our ancestors knew what they were doing. The foods that they ate were not just eaten because it tastes good. They were not a taste good society. You and I live in a society today that's a taste good society. We eat most things because it tastes good. That's pretty much it. Not because it's good for us, but because it tastes good. They were from societies that were, it is good for me, thus let me make sure that it tastes good. You understand the difference? And so that's how we have to approach this idea of when we're talking genetic survival, when we're talking African culture and how European dis-civilization, people say, what do you mean dis-civilization? Is there such a word? Dis-civilization would imply taking civility and destabilizing it. When you destabilize the spirituality, the finance system, the music system, the architectural system, the culinary system, the fabrics or clothing system, the way a person walks, in fact, the linguistical system, you've destabilized or decivilized that group of people. So Europe has practiced a decivilization of melanated world. They didn't bring us civility. They didn't bring, we wouldn't have to fight for civil rights if they brought us civility. We had culture, and our culture gave us civility, and they came in and they destabilized or decivilized our very ethos, everything that we stood for. And so we now have to say there's work that need be done. And that work starts from everything I've been taught has been a lie.
Fantastic. Now, I know you also have a PowerPoint presentation that you're going to present to us. To bring this to the community visually as well as auditorily. Let's put that up on the screen, and there it is. I love that. That is the key of life right there. That is it. Yes, indeed. Love that. Go ahead, my beloved. You're full you're on the left-hand side. If you want, I can still go full screen so everybody just sees the slide presentation as you talk.
That's fine. You can do slide presentation. That's fine.
Okay, great.
And I put this on anytime we do a PowerPoint or any presentations, I put this there because I'm saying to people, it's more than just the Ankh is the key to unlock the door, but what about the Ankh? The Ankh calculates earth, wind, water, fire. A key must consider the physical components. A key must consider the emotional components. A key must consider the spiritual components. A key must consider the mental components. This is what we teach at the Holy Coptic Church of the Black Messiah. But then that key, just going into the lock alone, will not unlock the door. It requires your and my involvement. That's the source and force of divine willpower that gives you and I the willpower to turn the key. Many a Black person, many a melanated person has information from Egyptology to Moorish Science Temple of America to the Nation of Islam to the Hebrew Israelites to the Moors to the Nuwapians to the Al-Kubalan to Meduneter, and we can keep going and going and going. Everyone has a key, but are we going to turn the lock? You see, a species, as it says here, with amnesia, truth is only visible to those who are able to question everything that they have been taught to believe. Truth is only visible. You cannot see the truth if you're not willing to question everything that you've been taught to believe by anyone, including myself. If you're not willing to question it, then you cannot find truth. So what we're doing is we're looking, you and I, on how to brainwash our people. Now, most people will say, well, I, what do you mean brainwashed? You want to brainwash me? Yes, our brains are dirty. You have misinformation and misteaching and lies. Absolutely. Then our brains are dirty. There's no way my
We need to wash our brains.
6-year-old, 7-year-old, 30-year-old, 40-year-old, 50-year-old, taking in racism, white supremacy in its various forms, from the television to movies to magazines to educational systems, which they admitted was set up to reprogram or re-educate indigenous people, forcing them to send their children to schools to be re-educated. So our brains are dirty. They made you and I think that brainwashing was bad, when in fact, brainwashing, what it really implies is washing the filth out of our brains.
If you and I, it's cleansing our minds.
Cleansing the mind. So we need a brainwashing.
Love it.
There's a book that I have years ago. It says it's called A Synthesis of the Russian Textbook on Psychopolitics. And they say psychopolitics is the art and science of asserting, putting white minds in black bodies, and maintaining dominion over the thoughts and loyalties of individuals, officers, bureaus, government agencies, and masses, and effecting of the conquest of enemy nations through mental healing. And they put mental healing because they'll tell you, oh, something's wrong with you. And I think my brother, Rev Shock, you always say, nothing's wrong with black people, something happened to us. Mm-hmm. So mental healing is what they'll teach you and I. Oh, mental wellness, but they're not really focusing on healing us nor making us well if everything they're going to give us is going contrary to our original indigenous ways.
Mm-hmm.
We wrote a book some years ago called Are You Student Mind, Slave Mind, or God Mind? Very interesting book. And it looks at the fact that we've been, and this goes all the way back to MK Ultra with the CIA of the 1960s, about reprogramming an entire society, in fact, the entire world. And when we look at that, we say here, a speaker of truth has no friends. So number one, you and I can't be looking to have friends. People who are gonna massage our ego and tell us we're right and they're gonna agree with everything we say. That's number one. Number two, we must teach the children that Africans are not one level, iota, one small iota, inferior to Europeans. In fact, we are greater than. We don't want to be their equals. You understand?
No doubt.
And then you and I have to say that being from Africa is the best thing that has ever happened to me.
Ashe.
Now, when we begin to look at African culture and how it reconstructs or was deconstructed or decivilized to give us European so-called civilization of what's present day called Westernized society, we go back to 1885 with the Belgium Conference. The Belgium Conference was to figure out how to break up the glorious past of Africa, how to take this glorious doctrine, glorious teachings, that proof on the walls and statues was from you, and then divvy it up, carve it up into minor pieces or major pieces, in fact, for the wealth of the continent and of the world. These groups of men gathered there at a time, my brother, where they were affixed with controlling not only Africa's resources, but the most important resource of the African continent, its people, those on the continent and those, of course, today of the diaspora or the diaspora. This is what the map would have looked like in 1880 as far as European incursion into the African continent.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what it looks like in 1913, just about less than 30 years after the 1885 Belgium Conference. Important that our listeners and our viewers bear this in mind. We're not just saying African culture bred European civilization because it's nice. No, they actually destabilized you, took your template, and added a facsimile or a pseudo covering onto that skeletal structure or template. Africa again, 1914. Belgium, Congo in the center. Angola, Portuguese would be there. Union of South Africa, the Dutch and the Boers and the British. German East Africa, the Germans, Anglo-Egyptian Sudan. Of course, that's the British again. And then, of course, Libya, which would be the Italians. And then French West Africa, as you can see. So they divvied up the entire continent. And when they did that, it gave the appearance that the people, because they took the wealth of the people, that the people were poor. But we instead say that Africa is not poor. Africa was being looted. Looted of her resources. When we talk about culture, I want everyone to see it. This is the etymology of the word culture. 15th century, which would be approximately 1401 to 1499 AD, they would say. The tilling of land is culture. So when we talk about culture, we cannot say Black culture and Black people are not tilling land and not cultivating food, crops, livestock, etc. Then you can't be a culture.
Mm-hmm. These
cultures are able to be identified by their language, by their food, and by their dress. So if we're not making our own clothes and controlling our fashion sense, if we're not putting forth food that speaks specifically to our culture and our ideas and goals, and if we're not wearing clothing that is easily and readily identifiable, or being able to be identified as who and what we are, we lack culture. Culture, again, the tilling of land, from the Middle French cotieri, or cochere, and directly from Latin cultura, a cultivating agriculture. So culture has to deal with agriculture. African culture has to deal with African melanated indigenous people being able to grow agriculture, and we say agrarian lifestyle. It means to care, to culture, and honoring. From the past participle, stems from colliri, to tend, to guard, to cultivate, to till. Because you would guard your crops against insects, guard your crops against other animals, and guard your stocks against invaders coming in and taking it. Now, in the figurative sense, it says cultivation through education. But miseducation would be to deculturalize a people. And this, it says here, is the intellectual side of civilization from 1805, that of collective customs and achievements of a people.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if culture breeds civilization, what is civilization? Culture is the tilling of the land, the agricultural cultivation through education, right education. Civilization is to make or render human. To bring out of barbarism, you and I were never barbarians.
Mm-hmm.
We weren't Berbers, and we were not barbarians. We were not savages. We were not pagans. We were not any of those things. These are all those words that apply to them, from them, about themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And it, from the French civiliser, verb from the old French civil, from late Latin civilis, relating to a citizen, relating to public life, benefiting a citizen, popular, of affable and courteous. We were never citizens of Rome, Greece, or any of these other European nations under this present system. So that would not apply to you and I. We take it a step further, and we look at this idea when we say cultivating of African culture. That means most people, if we ask them, and I've said this for many years, if I ask most people, and I'll ask you, my brother, how long ago was African culture, architecture, greatness? Most people will think about what? What would you say?
Well, they would think of the basically what's the, I guess, the biggest object in front of them, which is the pyramids and pyramids, what have you. But so most, but that's not the case.
Back. It's not the case. Most people are thinking back 1,000 years, 2,000 years, 10,000 years, when Africa was great, as you and I were being kidnapped in the 1600s and 1400s,
mm-hmm,
and Africa
mm-hmm.
was still great in 1885 when they were chopping
mm-hmm,
them up.
Mm-hmm,
so Africa's mm-hmm. greatness does not go back just thousands of years. It goes back. Go ahead.
No, something that you just said is so true, and that is, and I'll add to this: you don't steal something and take something that's not valuable.
Not just valuable, that isn't available.
Right. So the reason they hijacked and took every damn thing is because we were civilization. We are civilization. We are
the
only civilization. Right.
We're, so we're the so civilize all other people.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Please continue, beloved. Just wanted to throw that out there.
When Europe, the Indo-Aryans, the Indo-Orientals, when they came in contact with Africa, they de-civilized us. When we came mm-hmm. in contact with them, we civilized them. Notice the difference.
Africa's, that's right.
Africa's influence and Africa's contact with China helped fix China. Africa's contact with Japan improved the Japanese system. Ainu people, A-I-N-U. Africa's mm-hmm. influence and touching and interaction with Europe civilized them, the Moors and the Carthaginians.
Mm-hmm.
Africa's influence and contact with every people improved their lives. But not one group of people's contact with Africa did the same. So that tells you differences in the societies.
Yes.
So here we look at this idea of chronology. This is where, when you want to understand Africa's culture, breeding, or giving birth, or it directly influencing Europe's civilization, we must understand chronology. We must understand time. We must understand the system of dates and times and places. When Europe wanted to put herself as the object, as the great Bibi Marimba Annie says in her book, Yorugu, she says that they made themselves the object and the subject of everything. Mm-hmm. Never in a way that allows you and I, you and I to research their inconsistencies, inabilities, and weaknesses. So we have to approach it from that standpoint. If we presume everything we've been taught has been a lie, well, you and I have been taught about time. Call chronology, without being taught, rightfully, that chronology is named after Kronos. That anytime I look at the idea of chronology, I'm going to Hellenism. I'm going to Greece. Understanding that these players, when they talk chaos, and chaos giving birth to Gaia, and giving birth to Eros, and going giving birth to Erubis, and giving birth to Tartarus, that chaos is a person. So when they say out of order comes chaos, or out of chaos comes order, depending on who's saying it, they're admitting that their Adam and Eve story, not your Adam and Eve, but theirs, their civilization begins out of chaos. These names that they're talking about, Uranus and Gaia and Puntus and Montanus, and that these were Indo-Aryan gods. In Hindu mythology, Zeus is equivalent to Indra, or dare I say in Greek mythology, Indra is equivalent to Zeus. And when you look at Indra, we begin to understand that the first phase of taking African culture, repackaging it, and rebranding it was to change the words, the names, or the language of who was bringing it to you, and make that word or name or language replace, or being used to replace, the indigenous cultural name and identification, because words have power because they affect how we perceive a thing.
Sure, absolutely.
We go further and understand the Titans. Now, most people, we will hear back in the day, Clash of the Titans, or we watch the Underworld series, or the X-Men and all this. That is more, sounds mythological, but the Greeks, the Romans, the Hellenists, they lived by this, not as a mythological being. These were actual Roman kings or Greek rulers who they gave equivalent status to their people as being a god for their conquering ability. African theology or cosmology, to become a divine being, you had to do it because of your creativity. You had to be creative. You had to be able to be inventive. You had to be able to be a thinker, an analyzer, a strategist. Europe's ability to be a leader, you had to be a destroyer, a conqueror. Think of different congregations or societies. One, a culture cultivating, thinking, analytical, creative. The other, a destabilizer, deculturizer, decivilizer. you follow? Warmonger, focused only on taking other people's stuff. This is the thief, the murderer, the rapist versus societies that were not that.
Facts.
These constructs here, all of this iconography, these symbolisms of Zeus riding on and with a snake in the front and a sickle. The Norsemen, when you go back to before Zeus, they had Odin, you had Thor, you had Loki, you had a place called Valhalla. The word Valhalla, the word Hala, heal, Hellenists. The Hellenists were born out of Norse mythology, Greeks. And they had a family tree. And I'm doing this again because African success, melanated success, was only but a few, maybe 100 years ago. But you're looking at 1885, you were still awesome cultures. And I want our people to see that today. Once they Hellenized everyone's mind, whether they called it monotheism, whether they called it Judaism, whether they call it Islam, whether they call it Christianity as it's taught today, all of these as they are being given. I'm not saying, like the great Dr. Henry Clark said, we're not saying there is no real Christianity. We had Christianity thousands of years before there was ever a person who they're calling Jesus Christos or Jesus Christ. We had Islam thousands of years before there was a person who they're calling Muhammad of the Arabian Peninsula, of the people of Nejd. They call him Musalima Muhammad. And then we were Hebrews way before the advent through the people called the Khazars of Russia into an idea of a European called Moses. We had these theologies, cosmologies with a totally and completely different understanding as mm-hmm. to the system. So I'm going to move through again. These are some of the Greek gods: Kronos, Rhea, Memnosine, Themis, Hyperion, Thea, Oceanos, Tethys, Chorus, Phoebe or Phoebe, Krios, and Iphitus. Now they become important because there's 12 major Titans, 12 major Olympians, 12 tribes of Israel. Didn't say there's no real Israelites. I'm saying someone is usurping power by inserting their interpretation based off of their system.
Mm-hmm.
We look mm-hmm. at geography. The great Dr. Ben Yochanan, Dr. Ben, he spoke about the motherland, this motherland, Al-Kubalan, which we call Al-Kubalan or Afroica. And we recognize that this area, which the Greeks call Afrique, was meaning without cold, that this was designed by knowing geography, by knowing geology, by knowing topography, by knowing migration. We are able to retrace the past, retrace where things began, blueprint where we are now in this journey, and then foretell where we will be going in the future. We're talking Bantu migration as a result. The great Bantu migration took place approximately 2,000 years ago. And this mm-hmm. great Bantu migration was one of the most important, as I said here, I wrote it out, human migrations to have occurred since the first human ancestors left Africa more than 1 million years ago. The great Bantu migration lasted for about 1,500 years or more, and it involved movement of people whose language belonged to what we call the Congo-Niger language group. And this Bantu, this would be the great census story of people migrating, because if it took place 1,500 years of migration, is this the great census story of Jesus's character 2,000 years ago?
Mm-hmm.
In and around 1,500 to 2,000 years ago was the great Bantu migration. When someone takes that cultural reality that's been proven 1 million times over and tries to Hellenize it, they'll say, oh, Jesus's mother Mary and Joseph were told they had to go back to Jerusalem for the great census taking. What is the chance that the great census taking of the biblical rewriting in the New Testament by the Romans through the Vulgate happens to align at the same time of the great Bantu migration? Is mm-hmm. that a coincidence?
Mm-hmm.
We need that to each person to think on. Now,
phenomenal.
We go further, and I'm moving through it as we do. Otherwise, most of the time when we think of dates and times, this individual, which I'm sure all of your listeners that are watching know his name, I'm being facetious, I'm joking, but this individual from who was Dutch, who never, I'm going to say this again, never left the country he was in. Yet he's been responsible for writing and putting forth more maps about the world. His name was Olfert Daper. You got to study every side of the equation. We cannot only study the Black empowerment. We got to understand who these people were. He was a Dutch physician, Olfert Daper, and a writer. He wrote books about world history and geography. But listen to this. Although he never traveled outside the Netherlands. How can you write about this? Is not Google. There was no internet he could research. At this time, Europe, if you didn't go travel somewhere, you didn't get to see it. But he's going to write a whole history. In 1663, he wrote a book on the history of Amsterdam, and his description in 1668 of Africa was a key text for African studies.
Mm.
His book is one of the most authoritative 17th century accounts on Africa published in German. Translations of his book appeared in English, French, and German. Daper never traveled to Africa, but used reports by Jesuit missionaries. So Jesuit missionaries, whose mentality or ideals were influenced directly by the church, give him reports, and off of that, he's going to write on Africa. And also, he says here, he used other explorers. But then within a few years, he published about China, India, Persia, Georgia, and Arabia, a man who never left the country he was in at that time. His books became well-known in his time. Be mindful of how this works. This is a map of the world. They refer to this map as the most accurate that the Europeans put forth, called Peter's True Projection Map. Look at the size of Africa. Look at the size of Spain up here, for those who may not know. Look at the size of Italy, the boot. Look at the size of England, Scotland, and Wales. And compare these to the actual size, what they are, and the actual size to scale of the African continent. Once we do that, we realize that Africa is large enough, not just culturally superior enough, or agriculturally superior, or anatomically or historically superior, but Africa in her size is large enough to take the United States, China, India, Eastern Europe, Italy, Switzerland, Germany, France, Belgium, Netherlands, Portugal, and put it inside.
Mm-hmm.
And the United Kingdom, of course, would sit down here. Peter's True Projections Map, a true representation of land area. Mercator map that they teach the children in school. Notice how small South America is. Notice how small Africa is made to seem in South America. And notice what their actual sizes are and understand who drew the map.
Mm-hmm.
Look at the size of these areas in Europe and look here. Someone wanted to give themselves a larger than life appearance.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. One of the things when we talk about Africa's culture, civilizing Europe, or European takes civilization taking and stealing directly from African culture, we have to understand cosmology. We have to understand astronomy and what they will create later called astrology. Solar biology or cosmological astronomy is important because it's predicated on the elements. It's predicated on earth, wind, water, fire, a hydrogen, helium, lithium, bromine, all the way through Einsteinium. It's predicated on you as a female and I as a male. All of us must understand this. Our culture began in many places, one of which is the Nile River Valley Civilization, as it's called. And this was based off of the divine female that mother was first, which anatomically and diatomically is correct.
Mm-hmm.
The process they're calling a daughter cell is a gender. Daughter is gender. I have six of them. And the gender they happen to be is female. Excuse me. We take that a step further and we look at how they didn't just look at cosmology, but they understood that everything happening above happens beneath. And they had technology, as the Dogon were able to see how Cyrus, the braided motion of Cyrus A and Cyrus B, they were able to calculate that before there was telescopes, as the Europeans would come to call them.
Mm-hmm.
So the question begins to be Africa. This is the Dogon depiction of how Cyrus A and B move throughout the sky. And they were able to do this before there were telescopes and things of that nature.
Incredible.
This dendera, you find it today in France at a place, a museum called the Louvre. And this zodiac of African cosmology, they say, or must be true, is the oldest cosmological record. And it contains earth, wind, water, fire. It contains the 99 plus one elements. It contains our nature, our mind, our spirit, our soul, our bodies, our emotions, etc., and how to calculate for the fact that we are a multifold being and stop letting everything be based off of monofold or monotheism or singularity thinking. This is another zodiac that's found called Lamassu. It's found from the palace of Sargon II, because indigenous Indus River Valley civilization, as it's called or misspoken of, was also a part of African culture. So much so that Sargon II, who biblically is known as Nimrod, is called the son of Cush. And Cush, we all know, is Ethiopia.
Mm-hmm.
The importance, why would it be important for us to even have this discussion? Why would Rev Shock be doing all of the countless interviews and discussions that he's doing? Well, we're in a period of procession. And procession mm-hmm. is a period where everything that you thought gets turned about.
Mm-hmm.
Current history and theories and belief systems a renewing or a revolutionary spirit or reviewing or revising cultural impact must take place. We're watching that happen today.
Mm-hmm. Rache.
When we look at the cultural impact, we're looking at a procession of, say, anywhere from 25,000 rounded up to 26,000 years. It's a cycle that the planet wobbles, the procession needle wobbles, because you and I, like a top, if we spin that top, as it starts to slow down, it'll begin to wobble and spin. That's important because that spin or that wobbling has a direct impact on the minds and mentalities of we as a people today. And this is understood. That's one of the things African culture gave to Europeans in such a way as to civilize them. Mm-hmm. These are the Dogon. And they look like primitive pagans to some, but everything they're wearing, from the cowrie shell mask to the bullhorn, was always about maintaining, through discipline and brotherhood or sisterhood, a protective air about that which we overstood was secret or sacred to us. So these are some more of the thievery of Europe taking African theology, cosmology, the Dogons, and so many others, and beginning to claim and restructure it as their own. I'm just moving a little fast for a reason, so we can, because this is something a lot of people don't realize is taking place.
No, this is good stuff. This is great.
If they did a map of the planet right now, after all the floods and tsunamis and earthquakes and fire tornadoes, the planet does not look the way we thought it looked 30, 40 years ago, 50 years ago. A lot of areas that were under, were above water are now underwater. So the maps that we're now looking at are beginning to look more like this. The areas being flooded and inundated is what they refer to of global warming, because we melanated people in our right consciousness and spirituality overstood the importance of being caretakers and tillers of earth and maintaining that. Everything's beginning to shift. Notice where things were, which is in the red. This is where Africa was. And notice where she is now.
Mm-hmm.
Everything's shifting. Where South America was on this red line here, look how far everything is shifting on the planet. Don't believe me. But this was African. The Dendera, the zodiac, speaks to that. These different plates, the African plate, the Eurasian plate, etc.
Mm-hmm.
African culture also gives birth to architecture. Now, people will ask, of course, why are there seldom or rarely any ancient buildings and monuments in sub-Saharan Africa? Well, it wasn't because sub-Saharan Africa didn't have technology. It's because the invaders came in with the scorched earth policy, which said, one, kill the strong and loot the land. Two, breed the weak. And three, deport or exile the smartest and most skilled in science, technology, engineering, agriculture, and mathematics. And then finally, D, colonial rule, white supremacy, or death.
Mm-hmm.
Here's some of the things to negate the ability of the enemy to live off the land. Both Boer and British had a scorched earth policy of killing all the livestock and destroying shelter, something that took place the same way. It says here, a New Zealand rough rider watches as the farmhouse is torched. Dead sheep lie in the foreground. This was how they would colonize or conquer areas of land where people live. But in Africa's architecture, here's one of the great architectural feats of the world today. The Great Mosque of Zengi, with its 15 to 24 inch thick walls, which you would say 40 to 60 centimeters. It was built on a platform measuring 245 by 245 feet. A football is 300 feet by 300 feet by 150 feet, because each feet is each yard is 3 feet. So we're looking at this. This is how massive this masjid was. It was as big as a football field.
Mm.
The inbounds. This is, but when you're looking at it here, it looks like it's nothing. When you're looking at the size of it, compare the walls to the people.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And these openings would create where heat would rise and escape and cool air would descend. We understood architecture. We understood or overstood when you're looking at the checkered system. These people, these melanated people, understood that this system was the yin and yang. You see the black and the white. You see the yin and the yang. You see the zebra. You see nature. You see the chessboard. They are very particular. We have always been a people who are very particular about our usage of color, size, strength, weight, gender. We understood that all of these things were variables, and they were not just variables, but they were important variables. Mm-hmm. We go down to the Great Walls of Zimbabwe. They will tell you the Great Walls of Zimbabwe, they will try to imply, were built by people from Netherlands or Holland or some other European nation, when in fact they were Africans responsible for constructing this mega city. There were Africans who were using technology to create huts or homes or houses or kraals that would allow for the entire family to not just live, but to survive and thrive. This is today when it finishes one of these homes. This is in South Africa. Notice the dome and how mm-hmm. is it fixed? There's some realities that are taking place, my brother.
Amazing
questions that's coming through, but African architecture, when you look at this construct, look at the way things are built. Look mm-hmm. at the size. And these places were cool in the middle of areas that would be considered too hot. Look at the churches at Liabeli.
Mm-hmm.
Roman Christianity. Look at the architecture. How did they build a church in the ground
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
that you can only see looking down or standing right on top of it? They mm-hmm. built these churches in the ground. How? First of all, where did the idea even come from?
Mm-hmm. Look
at the tombs in Kasubi in Africa today. We have our ancestral tombs. Look at the Igbo of Nigeria, what they call the Igbo pyramid, looking like the Nubian pyramid.
Hmm.
We had feats of architecture, traditional house in Jindi, in Mali. Now this looks primitive. Olatu architecture, Mauritania. It looks primitive, but this is what your pizza shops normally look like, the older pizza
factories.
Mm-hmm. So where they get the architecture from? A group of people called Ualata, the Ualata people of Mauritania, black people. So every next time you walk into a pizzeria and you see this design, to all the listeners, be mindful you're looking at African what? Architecture.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Najir mm-hmm. architecture.
You're looking at the stolen legacy.
Stolen legacy. A small mm-hmm. village located in Tahoe. Look at what they've built. Look at the size. Wow. Now, if we're looking down in this corner, if I asked anyone, where is this? Where would we say? Can someone, if you could guess, my brother, maybe someone in the chat room, where would you guess this is on the bottom left?
In terms of geographical location?
What if I told you a country this is in, where would you think this is?
Well, if I think somebody would probably first think it's Kemet or Egypt, somewhere in that area.
Right. When in fact, this bottom left is in Israel, the state of Israel today. So when they used to call primitive, it's primitive when you build it. When they build it, it's eco-friendly.
Come on now, Doc. I love that. Come on now.
I was explaining this today. I said, when you have big lips, your big lips are just big. Well, you do know your lips are an extension of the mouth, specifically your taste buds. They'll say, oh, there's no taste buds in the lips. But now they're saying, recently discovered, that larger lips have larger sense of taste.
Yep.
So there's something going on. So anytime you have something in your African culture, this is in the state of Israel, in the Jewish settlements, they're using African architecture, mud houses. Now look again, because I did it without saying.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Go back. Now look again at the architecture. They're taking African architecture. These are Africans who had done it years ago that looked primitive. They're taking African architecture, which is the same thing when they today heat and make these ceramic tiles that go on the top of the roofs of many people's homes in a warmer climate, like Florida.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Look at that, and we go forward. Eco-friendly construction, which natives of melanin origin already had.
Mm.
This is the Israeli camp that I just showed you.
Mm-hmm. They're
building homes in the Jewish settlements using straw
mm-hmm.
and metal framing in the center. When you use straw and metal framing in the center, you were primitive.
Fascinating.
Which is not a bad word, prime first, primitive, premise.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
This is African. This is the, they build it. They put mud on the outside, thatch roof, and they'll tell you and I that your thatch roof is no good. African culture giving direct birth to European civilization is not old. Here we have a young man in Nigeria, Kunle Adeyemi, and he's now working in Tanzania, or from Tanzania, born in Nigeria, and he's developing ways to develop new cities that are eco-friendly, massive cities. This is in Nigeria today. Here's one, the Mokoko Floating Schools of Lagos. Adeyemi's claim to fame is that his widely covered floating school in Mokoko district of Lagos, he built over the lagoon and gave the city its Portuguese name, effectively became a self-governing settlement due to the lack of government presence in the area. As Nigeria boomed, recently overtaking South Africa as Africa's largest economy, Mokoko has come under pressure from the government, as well as a well-known and distinctive informal settlement in the heart of Nigeria's largest city. Although neither sought nor approved by the government, the school utilizes traditional Nigerian forms in a modern way and is uniquely situated in the city of Mokoko, although only one building. The project proved easy to build and low cost and indicates a different and desirable trajectory for Lagos. They know overcrowding of cities, so they built a school that floats on the river. Students get on, and they have school outdoors, but it's on a river. That's ingenuity, African creativity. Well, the incredible. Same person, he drew from his academic skills and made what he calls the Mokoko Floating School for a multiple floating residential and commercial buildings. Now to build houses, as sea waters are rising and the tides are coming in and the beaches are being washed away, he said, we're going to have cities that are free floating on this water and mm-hmm. able to rise with the tides when necessary. That's African culture.
Mm-hmm. There's another
gentleman, David Ajayi, and he is a person, it says here, that's from Northern Hemisphere, using his considerable sway in the media to drive interest in African architecture responsible for everyone else. The very designs that we're looking at that you'll find in Washington, D.C., designed by African people. This is the Tayumi Theater in South Africa Theater, designed by and for African people. Kibera, mm-hmm. Nairobi, Kenya, a community cooker is fueled by refuse or waste that residents collect in return for time using the oven. When you do it, no one talks about it. When they do it, it's eco-friendly. This was said by former President Jacques Chirac of France, and he says, without Africa, France will slide down into the rank of a third world power.
Mm.
Former French President Jacques Chirac. Africa, Western Africa, not in 100,000 BC, but in the last century or so, there were mega cities that were met, mega cities that existed in the Western Hemisphere of the African continent. And no one wants you and I to know about this.
Mm-hmm.
This gentleman's from Yale University, and they found an ancient mega city larger than London, New York put together. And these people were melanated people, African people who ruled that land. And if you look closely at their headpieces, because a picture is worth 1,000 words, you're able to uncover or discover that African people, in fact, were the mothers and fathers of civilization. We go further.
Mm-hmm.
This is Unkanatin's works, what they call Akit-Aten. And this is how the European artists are drawing what it would have looked like. And these ruins are still there. Again, what it looked like or should be depicted as and what it ended up like after someone invaded and raised it to the ground. My brother Philippe, anyone with any questions inside the room at this time?
Phenomenal. Not at this time, beloved. So please keep going. This is incredible.
So here we're looking at Akit-Aten. This is a computer-generated drawing of what it would have looked like along the Nile River Valley. This is what we would have had, and this would have spoke to our melanated struggle, our melanated desire and inbred striving.
Well, this represents what would have happened if we weren't interrupted. Before we were rudely interrupted.
Correct. Before mm-hmm. they interrupted blacks. Now, it's not me saying it. This is Benin City, 1891, 4 years before the conference with Leopold and them. 4 years before this conference, 1891, look what Benin City, according to the British artists who arrived there, saw a mega city. He saw this type of architecture, 1891, not 10,000 mm-hmm. years ago. Then they have what's called the ruins of Loropeni, the 11,120 meters square property, the first to be inscribed in the country, with its imposing stone walls, is the best preserved of 10 fortresses in the Lobi area, and is part of a larger group of 100 stone enclosures that bear testimony to the power of the Trans-Saharan gold trade. You're looking at it now, massive acreage with just trees there, but these people before the invasions and the incursions and the kidnappings and the enslavement, these our sisters and brothers were designing, living their best life, black magic, or black people magic, black girl, black boy magic.
Mm-hmm. Ashe.
In Kerma, around 3000 BC, a cultural tradition began. It was an urban area that was built around a large mud brick temple known as the Western Dufufa. This is African theology, cosmology. Look at the size of this. Not what it's become, but look at what the size would have had to be.
Mm-hmm.
Stand next to this. And these were temples and ruins. The Great Zimbabwe Wall was once the capital of the Kingdom of Zimbabwe and existed for approximately 1100 to 1400, 300 years. During the country's late Iron Age, the monument, which first began to be constructed in the 11th century and which continued to be constructed until the end of the 14th century, spanned an area of 722 hectares, and at its peak could have housed up to 18,000 people. These were megacities. Look what the Dutch and the British and the Spanish and the Portuguese drew of what they saw when they arrived.
Mm.
Now, did most of us even know that in the 14th century, the city of Timbuktu in West Africa, in Mali, was five times bigger than the city of London? Timbuktu is five times bigger than the city of London and was the richest city in the world. Today, Timbuktu is 236 times smaller than London after they destabilized your mind and my mind. This is Timbuktu in the 19th century. So you're looking at 1801 to about 1899. This is what Timbuktu looked like.
Incredible. Absolutely incredible.
Here's more pictures of what they say they met when they arrived. And when you look at the architecture of the drawing, you begin to realize that we melanated people had a culture, sciences, education. Mm-hmm. Now, in the same area in Timbuktu, they found what was called the Malian Papyrus. So African culture, your records, this idea that Africans didn't have written records, everything was an oral history. Are you kidding me?
Mm-hmm.
Couldn't have been oral history. We just didn't want to tell you. This was actual historical. It's called the Malian Papyruses. And they have all type of records and cures and directions that can affect or influence melanated people and those who care to know in a balanced way. But we're struggling to do that because we're looking based off of their perspective or the eyes that they would want us to look through.
Mm-hmm.
When we say we African people were the original speakers of the Aramaic language before the Indo-Arabs who speak Urdu and some other variations of that language could come along, we would then be able to move through the world from a linguistically stable standpoint. This is Kumasi, the capital city of the Asante Kingdom in 10th century to the 20th century. So from 1000 all the way up, these cities were beautiful, but this city was blown up, destroyed by fire, and looted by the British at the end of the 19th century.
Mm.
This is happening today.
Mm-hmm.
Portuguese forces destroyed and burned down the Swahili cities of Kilwa and Mombasa. Europeans would retaliate and destroy their homes. We have to start knowing these things so that when you and I speak as people, people are able to hear what we're saying and not necessarily try to interpret.
Incredible.
This is in Ghana today, the great Ashanti kingdom. We had mastered.
Wow.
I'm leaving it there so people can see it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
King of Congo receiving Dutch ambassadors in 1642. Notice they come and they bow. They always say they come in peace. The city of Mwanga, how they drew what they saw when they arrived. Africa's greatness does not just go back thousands and thousands of years. It goes back about 100 years. This is down in Tiwanaku. You say these people are pagans, but they're the closest to African indigenous culture, and they're the closest to what we teach.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Now, of course, there's the great Baba Ivan Van Sertima. He spoke about this, and they came before Columbus. We have to get people to get back to reading what the great teachers and minds of this last century offered to you and I.
Mm-hmm. Incredible. Incredible. Beautiful. That's it. That's us.
This is all us.
That's us.
This is all us. All the Afro-Mexicano, Afro-Cubano, Afro-Brazilian. There's African people everywhere on the planet because at one time nobody here except African people.
Be one. And know your ancestry versus your heritage. Absolutely.
African culture has a science to it, has medicine, to it, has practices medicinally on how we think and how we feel, how we touch and how we smell, to make sure that we are maximizing our interactions. So when you look here and you see the sciences of the great master scribe and teacher known as Yimhotep or Imhotep, please understand, is not someone putting something because you want to convert people. You're putting something because you want to help brainwash people. You want to get the lies out of the brain.
This
papyrus that Imhotep or Yimhotep put forth, one was called Egyptian medicine, which was the oldest manuscript on trauma and surgery. This is important because when we start dealing with trauma and trying to assist Black people and get us to stop self-medicating, trying to solve our problem because, okay, I can just do this like this. No, we need these manuscripts and the ability to read them and see what did our ancestors write. Like I said, presume everything they said was right. How do we get back to that right? And so they gave ways in which to treat trauma and surgery, trauma, mental trauma, emotional trauma. They were focused on that and made the quest to find and solve that problem a key towards our medicine or sciences and or our day-to-day well-being. If we pick back up what they gave us and just apply it, this text is devoid of magical thinking. It has 48 typical cases of trauma in anatomical order. Each case has details on injury, examination, diagnosis, prognosis, and treatment. Never of earth, surpassing that of Hippocrates of 1,000 years later. In this book, they were very concerned in the book called the Magical Thinking, if you will. Its focus is to make people know something has happened to me and I must be one who is participating in fixing it because no one else is coming. 48 typical cases of trauma in anatomical order. Each case has details on injury, examination, diagnosis, prognosis, and treatment. Level of knowledge surpassing that of Hippocrates of 1,000 years earlier. He was concerned with nutrition and hygiene. You and I must make sure our hygiene and nutritional levels are correct. Are you still there?
Wow, this is incredible. Wow.
Right? Now, this is phenomenal. We find this also in the Edwin Smith Papyrus, a manual on trauma and surgery. So all of those that are psychiatrists and psychologists and into the mind and trying to help the mind, we need to have a sit down. You need to be taught or shown how to read the hieroglyphs so you can understand how to deal with psychological trauma and how best to assist in waking our people up to the trauma that we've been experiencing without realizing it.
Mm-hmm. Ashe. Ashe. Oh.
So it's our responsibilities. One of the ways they would write it, they said that the advent of medicine and ancient Kemet, the medical papyruses would be recorded, important aspects of ancient African or Egyptian medicines, concepts of anatomy and physiology, magic in the ancient Egyptian medicine, holistic healers, pattern of disease in Egypt, the surgeon's role in drugs for therapy. When we meet people, we have to be able to break down, sometimes a very quick interaction, but to find what the person actually is attempting to do.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Fantastic, my beloved. This was another incredible journey, another incredible lesson. Thank you so much for bringing this level of culture to us. Because it's, again, seeing ourselves in the data. We've done so much, we are so much, that we sometimes forget some of the simple things and pleasures in life. And that is just the architecture, the science behind building and maintaining a civilization. Right. And also in your message today was wonderful is that this is not ancient Africa. This is really Africa today.
That's right.
The culture. And as you said, when they call, when we do it, they call it primitive. When they do it, what did you say they call it? Gentrification or eco, eco housing?
Eco-friendly.
Right. Yeah. So I appreciate you being able to bring out that level of dichotomy and just seeing past the BS, right. and bringing it to the community and making it plain that way. Right. Because everybody in the chat, everybody in the audience is like, wow, this is absolutely incredible. But you took us on a much needed visual journey and showing all of the layers and levels of the different types of archaeology around the world, not just in Africa, but how Africa is manifested wherever Africans are.
That's
which
right.
is everywhere.
Everywhere.
So what you showed in Israel, that was amazing because you, like I said, you think that was somewhere in Africa, somewhere in Egypt, you know, Kemet or what have you. It's like, no, this is Israel. This is what they're doing right now. Yeah, this is today.
And it's
very good. Very good. Go ahead. It's important
because it allows us to be able to know that the cure to our mental illnesses and instabilities, the cures to our health illnesses, the cures to our academic illnesses, the cure to our social and relationship issues, the mm-hmm. cure to all of those have already been recorded by Black people,
mm.
people from the great Niger Delta culture, the great Egyptian culture. If it's just up to you and I to go and read and research and apply what they gave,
mm-hmm.
trusting mm-hmm. that if it was done by then and worked before, then why would we doubt that it could? We lived for millions of years on this planet with no
Europeans,
and our system worked.
Right.
We're judging our system by a system that has only been active about 400 to about 1,000 years.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That is working. Not because I'm saying it, but the so-called scholars and political pundits, they're now saying the system is broke.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Meanwhile, so it's not like we Africans stopped using our system. We got invaded because our kindness was taken and abused. And through that invasion, we are now following systems that have not been proven to work.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
So, and when we did Revamp, which was our mental health and wellness presentation back in May, that's one of the things we were focused on, making people whole again.
Mm-hmm.
Making people mm-hmm. able to deal with what they're calling depression by understanding shame, guilt, and worry and depression. None of those are you. Something happened to you and I in a system that was designed for something, and with an S at the end, some things to happen to you and I.
Mm-hmm.
How many mm-hmm. of us, even in the so-called conscious community, can honestly say we escaped racism, white supremacy, into our Africanness, culture, religion, whatever it is, without having been taken through depression, repression, doubt, shame, fear, and everything else that was a part of living under their system and thinking, worst of all, by way of that same system?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yeah, so we have medicinal healing ways of as far as your sore throats, as far as digestive problems, rashes and skin burn, bad breath, headaches, asthma. These Edmund Smith papyruses, we had the Calhoun gynecological papyrus, we had the Ebers papyrus, we had the Hearst, we had the Chester, we have in Berlin, we have here in London, in British Museum, British Library. We had sciences. They were treating mm-hmm. intestinal diseases and parasites. treating intestinal diseases and parasites, eye and skin problems, abscesses and tumors. We were using remedies that were found in what they're calling the Ebers papyruses, which they admit was written by Imhotep. So African culture civilizes the world medicinally. African culture, not me saying it, but this is what you find. Malian papyrus, they had board meetings weekly for, this is thousands of years, and weekly meetings where the clinical oncologists discuss patients and solicit opinions of their patients and peers, meetings to study cases about organs and types of cancer or tumors called breast cancer. They were doing it then. Most of us don't even know. This is in the Malian papyruses that they say the primitive people living in huts for thousands of years came forth with back in 2012.
Wow.
It said their relatives had passed it down for generations, and the world is in shock still. Look up, anyone, if you dare, the Malian papyrus. The Edwin Smith papyrus talks about breast cancer so much so that they show a woman with one of her breasts having been removed. Statues in Kemet where the breast is missing or exposed, these were facilities where they studied oncology of tissue that had become mutated or what you call cancerous today. We've been treating this. Edmund Smith goes back 2,500 to 3,000 BCE before Christian era or influence. But no one wants to talk about it. We had skeletal systems on the walls of Kemet, carved and drawn before they gave us this, before they gave us the medical encyclopedias. They found these on the walls of Kemet. You had to study of the skeletal system because we understood as above,
so below.
And so we put our focus on studying everything and said, if I understand the human body, here's the drawing as it comes off the walls, take it off and I'll bring it up. Each of these we understood was important towards our life eternal. We observed babies being delivered through cesarean. African practices. And not to to avoid even talking about the murder and gruesome testings that were done on Black women during slavery.
Right.
And there's a book on it, and I'd advise everyone to get it, Medical Apartheid. Well, before the apartheid taking place to us, we had Black women able to deliver Black babies at the hands of Black doctors and nurses without all of these issues.
That's right.
They gave cures to things like ulcers, hemorrhoids, diarrhea. They gave cures to things like what's everyone walking around today, Crohn's. Can't digest anything, struggling with digestive issues. Or are we struggling because we're not growing our foods? If we don't cultivate our own foods and we keep eating foods that's been GMO, the body's not allergic to the food. The body's having an allergic reaction to the chemicals that are used to spray the food. You follow? They dealt with spinal cord injuries. Edwin Smith papyrus, Imhotep. The treatments in this text are often organized into groups.
For example, now, what you're showing, family that's watching and those that will be watching later, this first frequency signal and knowledge that you that you're being presented with by Dr. AJ Varmah is in you, is in us,
it's in us, and it's waiting for you to not just go
and it's waiting for us to wake up,
and then get that next generation to become gynecologists, to become the scientists, to become the engineers, the plumbers, the because we if we were building aqueducts, then we had plumbers. You follow? And so this is important. This we had medical knowledge on ophthalmology. When I have some younger people,
the pyramids had lights. The pyramids had lights, so we had electricians.
They said, "Well, I says, what should I be? Go become an optician, and then work your way to an ophthalmologist, and work your way." We dealt with these things. They didn't tell you that all of the medicinal tools that are used today in a dental office, all the scalpels that the Romans say they were using in 500 and 400 BC, all of these tools are found where? Medical instruments, but look at the walls of Kemet and tell me you don't see the dental tools. Look.
They're right
These are the tools that were in Kemet and in Africa, the rest of the African continent, down in Congo, down in Zaire, Mozambique, up in Botswana, Nigeria, all the way up to Libya, Fon Carthage, Tunisia. Look at the tools. Look closely. You see, this is on the wall. So somebody took your African culture, took the symbolism and the drawings and the carvings and the technology, repackaged it, rebranded, and only changed the name and said Europe dentistry, Europe science.
That's right. That's right.
Look at the surgical instruments of today. And look and find the surgical instruments of today on the walls of Kemet.
There they are.
But at the walls of Kemet, all of these surgeries were done under a system of Ma'at to do no harm, to only remove or cut out when all other options have been exhausted.
Mm-hmm.
It's not me saying it. These are surgical instruments, and it's on the temple of Kom Ombo, K-O-M-O-M-B-O, K-O-M-O-M-B-O. These are surgical instruments.
Mm.
The symbol for the drug symbol, Africa's culture takes and breeds European civilization by Europeans de-civilizing and deculturalizing African people. What they're calling the drug symbol today, look closely how the R is written and you see the symbol of the Eye of Ra. Look closely how the Eye is written with that line through it. And you see the drug symbol of today, because the original alchemists and phlebotomists and surgical professionals were African people, and thus our symbols were designed to speak to good RX, or they would say today. And they understood that one aspect of the eye was for the physical sense of touch, one was for the physical sense of sight, one was for the physical sense of hearing, right here for those wondering. You see this symbol here, the stalk, that represented touch. So when we were treating our people medically or spiritually or emotionally or psychologically, we understood you have 1/64th touch. So if a woman or man is going through some type of trauma from childhood abuse or something that took place or hanging out with the wrong guy or girl, then we have to understand that their part of their cure will be 1/64th touch. We have to have some form of touch or interaction with them. We would understand that aspects of the trauma or the successes, the successful memories of the gene, what they call epigenetics, or the traumas that's traumatizing the gene would have to deal with taste. We'd have to reorganize how we taste things, how we, you know, not just taste things, but the seasonings you use by growing your food, by growing your own peppers and growing your own olives and growing your own cucumbers and growing your own okras and different things. Then your taste buds would change to original taste, which would affect your eyes becoming one. When Christ said, "Lest your eyes become one," if your mind's eye is not recalibrated, if how you touch and how you taste and what you hear and how you think and what you see, your sight. So to see, hear, taste, smell, and touch, if all of these are not recalibrated correctly, what does it lead to? It leads to your death.
Leads to disease and death. That's right. If all
calculated correctly, you can escape death. So one group used this symbol for the cures to death or illness, and the other group used this symbol, and whenever you saw the pirates or the tomb raiders, you knew death and disease and destruction would follow. All going back to the Aten, we had dentistry. African subculture breeds or is destabilized and gives you westernization or Hellenization of the world. We were doing dentistry. The original grills, if you will, the original braces. We would call this African people. It's not me saying it. That's why these tools are there, because we had dentists. Go and get the book, Edwin Smith Papyrus, the first textbook in surgery. Barts and London Children's Hospital put it forth, King College in London.
Wow.
Written by Abdurrahman Ramaluddin and Salah Kamaluddin for the History Club. Read them if you dare. It goes on. All of that gets destabilized, African culture, and then here comes Freud. Here comes Darwin. Here comes Schrodinger. They take African Edwin Smith papyrus. They take African Ebers papyrus. They take the Malian papyrus. They take the Calhoun gynecological papyrus, and then they throw all of that behind the scenes where they can control how much information will be released that may be made readily available, and then they bring forth the origins of the species of natural selection by Charles Darwin.
Mm.
It was eugenically designed or written for the Eugenic Society to justify their mistreatment and dehumanization of melanated people.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Absolutely. Follow, follow you, my beloved.
They'll say men descended from the apes, yet when you say we come forth from women, people will doubt that. If I say women were first, well, I don't know if women was first, but every man came from a woman.
Right. Women were first. Exactly.
I'm not sure every man, Rev Varmah or Dr. Varmah, you said woman was first. Yes. Well, I don't believe it. But every man, including the person who don't believe it, came from a woman.
That's right. That's right.
But you say man was first, monotheistically speaking, but there's no proof of it. The daughter still exists.
Mm-hmm.
You say you came from a man's rib. Yeah, that makes sense. What about the animals that were there with Adam? Were they also taken from the rib of their male?
Come on. Break it down.
This years ago. This PowerPoint, I did this probably 15 years ago. Or if not longer. Asking the question, you say that man was taken, a woman was taken from man's rib. African culture says no, man was taken from woman's vagina. That's a fact.
That's a fact.
And spends the rest of his life trying to find one to climb back in. I'm sorry, it's the other side of me. Like, as that's happening, as he's fighting to get back, man came from a woman's vagina. We deny that. We deny that reality. Got men walking around wanting to get a vagina to hopefully give birth.
Isn't that crazy?
But they'll say that man gave birth to woman from his rib. So who gave birth to the female cat? Was she taken from the male cat's rib?
Right.
And who gave birth to the female elephant? Was she taken from the female, the male elephant's rib? And who gave birth to the female crocodile? Did she give? Was she taken from the rib of the male alligator or crocodile? It don't make sense. How can every other species originate from a divine egg, and that divine egg came out of a divine mother, crocodile, alligator, mongoose, wombat, Star Wars, right? Or some other creature, whether mythologically or realistically. And then when it comes to human beings, of all the mammals, the male ape knows he came from his mama. No male ape walking around with a little cut where a rib is missing. And so one breath, you come from the apes, and the next breath, you come from God. And another breath, men come first, women come after. Doesn't make sense. That's African theology, cosmology is going to be rebranded and gives birth to a system that's using your and my template. Because we don't want to deal with common sense. They'll tell us that man decides the gender. Man, he supplies the sex chromosome. But then they don't tell most people that the sperm stays in the female's body anywhere from 24 to 72 hours, where it goes through a process of an electrical current being placed inside of her womb. And based off that current in her womb generated by her body, it will determine the polarity of her body. And based off of that polarity, only the male or female sperms will survive to guarantee whether a male or female is born. So in fact, she determines gender. Not me saying it. Do a little research. We have what was called the pyramid text tubes, African culture birthing European civilization and religions, for that matter. On the walls, the decorations going back to the old kingdom, and you look at these decorations or drawings, what they call the Zep Tepi, when God enters the flesh for the first time. They say when God enters the flesh for the first time, they show you a splitting of the one egg into two. Well, that's nothing but meiosis on into mitosis. The gametes are splitting. Well, before they did this, you already had this that's on the left.
That's
African
right.
culture already existed. Your modern science of cell division, well, there's science of cell division. This one, you leave the woman out except calling it a daughter cell. This one, the woman standing right there involved in it. Which one would you prefer? I told everyone in the beginning, my brother, we must decide that everything we've been taught by them has been tainted to misguide us, miseducate us, misdirect us. So we must put down only reading theirs and accepting it. I will read everything they put forth, but I'm reading everything they put forth with the mentality that it is a lie.
Absolutely.
And then I'm reading everything our African ancestors and Native American and indigenous ancestors of the planet put forth and say it's the truth and make it my life work, which I've told people many times. I've made it my life work to take everything that Africa produced from ancient times, from anywhere on the continent, that we can find records of and carvings of, and saying it's 100% true. Now I got to spend my life and prove it.
Exactly. I'm not going
to approach it from a skeptical standpoint.
That's right.
And it's not even a couple of hundred years old. Doesn't make sense.
That's right. When we talk about
meiosis and mitosis, every person, this is a man's chest. You see the two eyes. You see the splitting of the body, what they call in the ribs. That's the process of meiosis and mitosis.
Mm-hmm.
The oldest bones found on the planet, African culture, they call it the bones of Lucy, Authoropithecines and Authoropithecine, Kenyan woman and Ethiopian woman, but they're always females, most completed bones found here in Hadar, Ethiopia, and prove what? That man comes from woman. If not, brothers, then tell me why you got nipples on your chest.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm sure some guys going to jump up and say, I give breasts, I have milk too. Right? But other than that guy who might have some milk, the rest of us, again, we don't have any use for these things on the chest.
None.
But it stands as a sign that we come from her. What else stands as a sign that we come from her? African culture says we have a belly button. That belly button, as they call it, or umbilical button, or umbilical cord spot, means we had an umbilicus attached from that center point going to our mother.
Mm-hmm.
Now, show me on the female where she has something from her father connected to her.
Right, right, exactly.
And so we have to reevaluate African culture found in India. This is an Iranian. These are the Iranians. You go to Iran today, they're African people. You go to Iraq today, they're African people. You go to India today, they're African people. The great Baba Ranoko Rashidi, who's now fighting for us in the realm of the ancestral etheric realm or spiritual realm, as some misspeak it, they understood this. These are not the natives of Iran. These are not the natives of India. These are not the natives of Pakistan. These are not the natives of Afghanistan. I'm going to show you again. Iran, Iraq, India. These are the natives. These are the invaders. Get the story straight.
Facts. This is great, bro. This is amazing. This is absolutely amazing.
Let's stop there. And next month, if you don't mind, my brother, Philippe, we can start.
We'll pick up where we look. Yeah, we'll pick up where you left off. Yeah, I love it. I love it. Absolutely. This is incredible. Look at that. Look at that. All right, my beloved family. You know, come on now. Y'all know what we do. You know, as Ray Charles say, we make it do what it do, baby. This is what we do. This is who we are. This is First Frequency. I have prided myself on being able to not just interview the most brilliant minds in the world, but to be able to pull out which are the, you know, what's the cream that rises to the top all the time. And those are the people that you will see have a repeat on my platform, because they give and bring a level of First Frequency knowledge that no other scholar can do. Dr. A.J. Varmah is one of those scholars. He's a scholar of scholars. Scholars follow his work. If you follow the Dogonic apprenticeship process and self-mastery process, you are familiar with Jiri So, Beni So, Bolo So, and So Dai. So Dai is who Dr. A.J. Varmah is. He is the one who is so exalted and perfect in his work that other scholars use and cite his work. And today was a great example of that. As I was looking in the chat, everybody's completely blown away. That being said, I would like to close this out, my beloved Dr. A.J. Varmah, with our affirmation of power, because you brought the heat today. So I just want to personally thank you for that. And I just would like for everyone to repeat after me, please. I am one with First Frequency.
I am one with First Frequency.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the first thought idea.
I am one with the firstborn people.
I am one with the firstborn people.
Therefore, I am one with the only one.
Therefore, I am one with the only one.
Ashe. And so it is.
And so it is.
My beloved, I thank you so much for this cipher. This was amazing.
Thank you so much.
Blessings to your family and safety and travels. Now, before we leave, if you would quickly, I know you have an event that you're doing that you do every year, actually. And
right.
Is this the second or third time that you're doing this?
It's been done over a decade, but the last 2 years was strictly online because of COVID protocols.
Because of COVID, right. Okay.
Now we're back, and this time we added another feature because the technology exists with the different streaming platforms that we can broadcast from all four locations that we're doing it from: the United Kingdom, Trinidad and Tobago, Nassau, Bahamas, and Greenville, South Carolina. We're telling people go to Eventbrite and type in International Culture Day, and you can get your tickets online and not expensive. Or you can also go to our website, journeyhomegroup.com, and you can purchase your tickets. You'll see the link on the homepage for International Culture Day. You can attend if you're in London. You can actually go to the event. If you're in Greenville, South Carolina, you can go to the event. It's going to have dancers and drumming and lecturers and speakers and food, right? If you're in Trinidad and Tobago, or if you're in Nassau, Bahamas, you could also go in person. But if you're unable to go to those physical locations, you can get your tickets, and you'll be put in a WhatsApp group that gives you the code tomorrow morning, and you click, and you'll be able to watch the entire thing. It starts at 10 a.m. Eastern Standard Time, which for the United Kingdom would be 3 p.m., and it will last all the way up until 9 p.m. in the UK, which would be 4 p.m. in the afternoon Eastern Standard Time. If you're in California, that means it would start at 7 a.m., and if it ends at 4, that means it'd be over at 1 p.m. So we're telling anyone, please support it, check it out. You won't be let down, I promise you. We don't bring forth a product that's not put together. We have people, about 30-something people, plus other people and other people. We got layers of teams that have been working on this for months now. And we have a lot of sponsors, Pepsi Company, Gatorade, so many sponsors. Let me see if I brought up the website quickly. I can read some of the sponsors that are involved in this event so that you know this is not a run-of-the-mill, just a thrown-together slap, as my brother said, slapdash, right? You have Pepsi. We have the Ministry of Agriculture and Marine Resources in Nassau, Bahamas. We have the Islands of the Bahamas. We have the ASA, a Solutions Agency, Global 99.5 FM, Tree of Eternal Life Stores Global, Angle Sutra, Colors Junkunu, Sip Sand and Sea, Parliament, the Minister of Parliament, Mr. Saddam Hussein, MP, not the one that they went after, Ankh Island, National Carnival Commission of Trinidad and Tobago, Flow, Righteous Jewels, we have Supreme FM Radio, Staples, Maximum Bass, Carib Direct, ARI, Music Class Piano, Thompson Trading Corporation, Just Music, YPP, which is Yankee Peddler and Pawn. We have AVC Services and Management, Extra Goods Care, San Juan Levantil Regional Corporation, Guitar Center, National Flour Mills Limited, Direct Waste LTD, Little Caesars is in the house, LEAD, which is Lordy Entertainment Arts and Dynasties, and then the Pizza King, Mario's. So we're putting something together, and we just, you know, we're telling people, come on out, support it. You won't be let down. If you can't come out in person, get your tickets. Again, go to Journey Home Group, JOURNEY, Home, HOME, Group, GROUP. Click it. And it's, you know, we're not profit, as they would say. We're non-profit. We're out here getting things done, but we are using whatever resources and finances we can raise to build. When we talk grow our own food, we have land in Trinidad where we grow food, land in America, in Greenville, South Carolina, in Mississippi. We have land in the UK, allotments. We have places where we grow food. Wherever we are, we grow food. Wherever we go, we grow food. In Liberia, we grow food. In Ghana, we understand if you can feed yourself, clothe yourself, and house yourself, everything else will come easy. So that's what we're doing.
I appreciate that, my beloved. And so the website is on the screen, journeyhomegroup.com. Go get you some of this. Go get you some of this love. Now, some of y'all need to have it in physical form. this is the perfect time and perfect place, right? But before that, it was online. So now you get to have the experience that can be coded inside of you and releasing that first frequency experience. I just absolutely love it. Thank you, beloved. We'll see you in 30 days.
All right. All right.